Fear, the great unifier, the one primal urge that brings us together and makes us cower in the dark. There is nothing to fear but fear itself, they say. But what about the monsters? What about the gnashing teeth and salivating jaws? What about the hungry beasts rattling at the door, starving for flesh and gristle and bone and gore? What about the worst ones? The ones who wear faces that look quite a bit like yours. The ones who look through bone and sinew and flesh and skin with eyes almost human, but not quite. What if you brought a gun to a knife fight, and a sword the size of the creature threatening your life? What if you were the thing that gave them a fright? Bloodborne's bark is worse than its bite. FromSoftware games have a bit of a reputation for slamming your head in the door, and in some regards it's warranted. They are punishing experiences, where a moment's hesitation in the wrong place could spell death, and there's nothing more humbling than getting your ass handed to you by some wiry little nobody who looks like a sultana. Bloodborne feels slightly different, though. It is still a difficult game, especially for Dark Souls veterans. It's faster, more vicious, but it also requires an entirely different approach to combat. Shields are nice, but not if they engender passivity. With this perspective change, Bloodborne's combat not only feels faster and more aggressive, but changes the relationship you have with the world. It's not that desperate fight for survival that cemented Dark Souls as one of its generation's most formative experiences. You are not a victim, you are a hunter. You are seeking out the horrors of Yharnam with your trick weapons and molotovs and ability to tear through the chests of things living, undead, and those that lie between the planes of existence. And you'll die, a lot, at first, because the fact that you are something to fear doesn't make your prey any less vicious, and sometimes your blades and bullets won't even stop the onslaught. These are feral creatures, some of them even mad, beyond any meaningful comprehension of the world around them. Some of them are even beyond your comprehension, pushing you towards insanity just by sight alone. Yharnam is not a safe place. And even though you are just as dangerous, it doesn't make it any less a threat. Bloodborne has the same mitigation factor as the Souls games, however. It's an RPG. It has the option to grind your way out of a tough situation, to a certain extent. By going out of your way to collect blood echoes, blood shards, blood... well, blood everything, you can build yourself up into something that cuts through the environment like a hot knife through butter. It doesn't make the game a cakewalk, but it makes any potential mistakes that little bit less mortifying. And eventually you'll get to the point where you start to perceive the things in the shadows and those under the light of the blood moon for what they really are. Vessels of flesh and bone, finite things that can be returned to the cosmos with enough determination and firepower. On return visits to the game, the things that felt insurmountable in its opening areas suddenly take on a new, less daunting light, in theory. Bloodborne is a game where difficulty is largely contingent on the unknown. You die because you get caught off guard by something or someone, ambushed by witches or scared into inaction by some great terrible beast. It's not a game of random chance, however. There are patterns to be recognized, and through death one finds the knowledge to potentially avoid the same fate next time round. You and your foe, trapped in an endless cycle of violence, death, and rebirth. Eventually you grow wise or grow stronger, and the things that go bump in the night cower in your presence. The thing is, under normal circumstances, this reversal of prey to predator should by all rights diminish the horror of the game, turn it into a gothic, Lovecraftian version of Bayonetta or the like, something that takes on the aesthetics of horror but leaves the tension and fear at the door. But it doesn't. Bloodborne, no matter how strong I make my character, no matter how well I know the streets of Yharnam, remains a fucking terrifying experience. In a place where death is no real barrier to progress, and with such formidable weapons at your disposal, this should not be the case, but it is. A fight finished, no matter how many successful attempts, still leaves me with my heart trying to punch its way out of my chest like a visceral attack. As I walk from the unknown to the familiar, the chill never leaves my spine. The terror of what I have to face remains steadfast. The things that go bump in the night, they still go bump. God, what a strange expression that is. It could be strongly argued that the aesthetics of horror games are paramount to their experience. The way they look, the way they sound, how much of them you can actually see. It's a delicate dance of different palettes forming to create something genuinely dread-inducing that nonetheless pushes you further into it, rather than away. The fear of death is one thing, but it's the fear of depths that leaves you shaking and sweat-drenched in the middle of the night. And there is this great unholy marriage of the strange and the familiar that lies at the center of any successful horror experience. We fear that which looks like us as much as that which does not. In Bloodborne's case, there is this weird cycle that almost every player has while confronting its great terrors, which I believe is the key to understanding this strange phenomenon. I want to talk about a specific boss as a key example of what I mean, but first we must go back to the beginning. That first encounter in the clinic. Locked eyes with a terrible beast, no weapons at hand, you find yourself in a precarious situation right off the bat, where victory is possible, but not the intended result. On first encounter, you will likely die to this foul creature and awaken in the hunter's dream, wherein you will choose your weapon, return to the clinic, and tear that wolf a new one. This is a formative experience, because it teaches the player from the offset that everything that poses a threat to your life has the capacity to bleed, to be subverted and destroyed. There begins a gameplay loop in which you encounter something horrible, dig in your heels, roll up your sleeves, and in all likelihood get absolutely bodied. It's a steep learning curve, admittedly. However, each attempt to slaughter your prey brings with it a rising comfort of familiarity. Even if you die, you can return, perhaps strengthened by the grind or with a new strategy, wise to the tricks and to the tells, replete with the knowledge of which moves are actually dangerous and which are merely a twisted form of Batesian mimicry. And eventually, you make it. The beast felled. The words, "prey slaughtered," emblazon the screen, and a moment of elation. You made it. You faced down that which strikes fear in the heart of man, and you killed it, in turn killing a piece of the fear that is trying to keep a stranglehold on you. That elation is cut short by the knowledge that you now once again have to face the unknown. Move once again from predator to prey, and stare down things no doubt more fucked up and evil than those you have recently brought to the blade. The game gets worse the deeper you dive, more dangerous, less predictable, increasingly non-Euclidean. The beasts and madmen are replaced by beings more alien, more eldritch. You pass through the streets of the city, into the woods, into dreams, into the heart of madness. Even returning to previous areas with eyes awakened will grant you fresh horrors, new sights, new sounds, new sensations. There is no relief from the ordeal of the unknown here. But it's okay, because the principle still stands. You meet some new, ugly, incomprehensible horror, you learn its patterns of behavior, you get stronger, you get smarter, you take it to the cleaners. And then you encounter the Witch of Hemwick. Or rather, you don't. Not at first. An empty arena. A health bar with nothing physical to provide context. A dark and shadowy being rises from the ground and you think to yourself, okay, here we fucking go. But you slay them, more keep coming. And no matter the damage you inflict, the health bar does not drain. Some beasts are bold. Others hide in the shadows. Many are imperceptible to the human eye. The Witch of Hemwick, she is an amalgam of all of these, appearing to you in brief moments, shielded by the distraction of the shadows hunting you down, a different kind of horror, adopting a different kind of tactic, misdirection. Now, you might argue at this point that once you know the gimmick of the encounter, then it's plain sailing from here on out. But fights like these retain their sense of dread thanks to the divide between knowing what you need to do and actually being able to do it. And this is the key element for which it could be argued that Bloodborne needs its level of challenge. The Witch teleports around the arena in ways barely perceivable, even if you are actively seeking her. With this deadly game of cat and mouse, and the shadows leaving no corner safe, the game suddenly becomes less reactive and requires more planning, something that may not come naturally as your pulse increases. And then a second witch turns up, which is, frankly, a bit rude. The footage I've used for this segment of the video is of perhaps the third or fourth time I've fought the witch. I've gone in knowing the trick, and still spent my time unnerved. The layout of the arena and the constant It Follows-esque pressure of being slowly pursued by creatures that aren't even really to do with the boss is all designed to trip you up, to push you towards making that one fatal mistake. This is what FromSoftware are good at. Encounters that offer a challenge through tough, merciless combat, but mitigate the diminishing returns of knowing what to do by capitalizing on the player's mental state, wearing them down, step by step, warming them to one overwhelming experience before tripping them up with another. It makes the hunt a war of attrition, contingent on the player's personal constitution, their ability to remain calm in the face of experiences that test the boundaries of logic. Everything in the game is built around this idea that you need to keep on your toes at all times, no matter how seasoned and bold you are. Shields are nice, but not if they engender passivity. Bloodborne excels at what it does because it understands what it means to be afraid. A sort of anti-power fantasy, it utilizes its setting, its art direction and sound design, as well as the generally twisted nature of its world's rules, to craft fear into an almost tangible game mechanic. One arguably as important as the trick weapons, blood echoes, and visceral attacks. It's a game in which success is often a more mortifying ordeal than failure. The mechanics of fear are broad and malleable. As with anything intrinsically tied to psychology, there are no rules set in stone. By refusing to make the player's dread solely contingent on the threat of a fail state, the game's impact lasts longer. As much as it is reliant on the threat of the unknown, I don't think anyone would argue that it stops being scary once you know its tricks. It's that masterful amalgamation of design, empirical challenge matched with a psychologically draining aesthetic, which makes Bloodborne a lasting fixture of this generation, more so than anything else I've played.